Hello and welcome to our special show, Fighting COVID with Dr. Randeep Guleria. I'm Gargi Rawat. This is the show where we try and get you all your questions answered on coronavirus. Thank you so much, Dr. Randeep Guleria, for taking time out and joining us on this show, which I have to say is anticipated highly by people across the country, and not just regular people, but even doctors across the country. Well, we'll jump right in since we have many, many questions for you. First and foremost, Dr. Guleria, what do we know so far about the variant that has been discovered in India? Is it more infectious? Already we have a report from the UK that says that they feel it's as infectious as the variant that was discovered in the UK last year.
Yes. So if you look at biological data, based on the number of cases that we're seeing in areas where the variant is being reported, there is a huge surge as far as the number of cases is concerned. Therefore, one could conclude that, yes, this seems to be a more infectious data. But scientifically, we will need to develop a clinical epidemiological correlation. That is that you see that in a particular area, you are seeing this variant becoming the dominant variant. And at the same time, you are able to show that this is linked with increase in the number of cases as was done in some. Then we have definite evidence. But if you look at what is available right now, definitely, this variant seems to be more infectious, and this is inherent with how the virus will behave as it evolves over a period of time.
And then the question that many ask after that is the vaccine that we currently have effective against this new variant?
So whatever data as we have as of now suggests that the vaccine does have efficacy against the new variant. Some arguments the efficacy may come down a little bit. But remember, most vaccines have an efficacy which is more than above what the WHO had said as a baseline of at least a 50% efficacy. Most vaccines have efficacy which goes up to 70, 80, or even 90%. So therefore, it is likely that vaccines will work. But the word of caution here is that the virus will continue to mutate, and we need to continue to have good genome sequencing, pick up the mutations, and evaluate it with the currently available vaccines in terms of efficacy in a sort of a war footing manner, so that we are ahead of the virus rather than sort of chasing it.
Right, and this is a point you've been making continuously on the show about how we need more data, we need more genomic studies on these variants. And I also want to ask you, now there are reports of sub-variants. So is there a difference between the variant which is B1617, then there's B1617.1 and B1617.2? Now, I've read that different variants or different sub-variants are being found in different parts of the country.
Yes, so there is subtle differences because these variants have different mutations. Many of them are at the spike protein, which means that these variants have the potential of being more infectious. What is the cause of concern is that are they also having a chance of causing what we call an immune escape mechanism? That is, is there leading to a higher chance of getting reinfection, or is it leading to less efficacy of the vaccine? And like I said before, these variants are emerging, and it's a cause of concern because as we have more and more number of cases, we're having more than 4 lakh cases a day. That means the virus is replicating to a large extent in our country. The more the replication, the more the chances of new variants developing, and the more the chances of that these variants will evolve, really develop a mechanism to become more infectious and become more, let's say, resistant to the treatment strategies that we have. That is why we need to also work aggressively in bringing the number of cases down, because that will help in decreasing the emergence of new variants, which may be a cause of concern in the long term.
Absolutely. And why is it called a double mutant variant when these mutants are present in other strains? And I know many experts and doctors have pointed out that this is something of a misnomer, and perhaps it's the media to blame.
So I think this is just trying to make it sound more dramatic. It's just that when you have mutants which are already there, so if you have mutations which have already been picked up in, let's say, two other variants, and they combine, and then you get a new variant which has these mutations which are already there in other variants, then you may sometimes use this term. But I think you're right, it's a misnomer, because these are also newer emerging variants which have developed mutations at different sites, and we know that even the UK variant had a large number of mutations, more than 17 mutations, as far as that strain was concerned.
And this week there was reports of another variant that has been found in Andhra Pradesh, though Andhra, however, denied it. But Delhi, you know, brought out some new rules for people coming from Andhra. So is there a new variant from Andhra?
So that is something that was reported, that there is a variant from Vizag, which is related to being more infectious in that area. We need more data, and that is what I'm saying, that you may pick up some variants which may be what we call variants of interest. They are variants which will happen as the virus replicates and evolves. But are these variants linked to more disease? Are they linked to more deaths? Are they linked to reinfection or decreased efficacy of the vaccine? Is something that we need to look at. So picking up variants is of not much concern, because that is going to happen, and that has been happening for more than a year. We need to link that with how is this variant affecting us from the clinical point of view, the epidemiological point of view, or the vaccine efficacy point of view.
So bottom line is, we need more studies, we need more data, and we need to get that fast to get ahead of this pandemic. Doctor, another point, you know, of concern is, why does it seem, and it is quite clear, that more young people are dying in this second wave of COVID than they died during the first wave of this pandemic?
So I think it's an issue that there are a number of young people who are having more severe illness. And as a matter of fact, our numbers are also much higher. So one is it absolute number or is it a percentage? It does seem that it's more of an absolute number rather than the percentage. It's also an issue that many people are delaying treatment, because we are seeing that large number of, especially the younger people, feel that they'll become all right and they stay at home. They really wait till the saturation dips, comes down to the 80s. And then they're running around finding a bed, and sometimes that creates a problem. So I think no matter what be your age, if you're home isolating yourself, if you have any of the red flag sign, that is, your saturation starts becoming less than 94, and especially if it's coming close to 90, if you're having breathing difficulty, if you're having high-grade fever, which is not coming down on the fifth or the seventh day, or you're feeling drowsy, you're feeling very, not your, the caregiver sees that you're not responding that much, you must not delay things, and you must definitely try and contact your doctor and get admitted. Because sometimes the delay is the cause of the mortality rather than the disease itself.
Right, you're absolutely right, you know, about young people taking those initial symptoms very, very lightly. And this brings me to the next question. What are the telltale signs of severe COVID in young people? Because, you know, it's just escalating so fast. You suddenly, the person is at home and it seems to be doing fine, and the next minute you're desperately searching for a hospital bed.
So that's the sad part, because of this huge surge in the number of cases, there's a huge strain on the healthcare system, because the number has increased so rapidly that you don't have that turnover that you would like, that people come in a manner where every 5 to 7 days you are able to discharge people and take in more people. The number of people coming now is huge. The telltale signs are that if you find that after the 5th to 7th day you still continue to have high grade fever, if you're finding that your saturation now, which is 97, 98, is now coming to 91, 92, or is dipping less than 93, if you start having breathing difficulty and you're not able to breathe properly, or you have drowsiness, some people have a lot of stomach pain, or any other atypical symptom that you think is not cannot be explained, please contact your doctor and consider getting admitted. It's better to be safe rather than have a problem later on. So any of these symptoms, please contact your doctor, and I would suggest that you should get medical treatment. Don't really start treatment on your own. That is also causing a lot of problems. People start taking steroids early, start taking other drugs early, and that sometimes leads to worsening of their condition rather than improving of the condition.
All right, we're going to talk more about that later on the show. But also the next question I have for you is about black fungus, because again, there are reports of this occurring in, you know, various hospitals in different parts of the country. I remember during the first wave as well, we reported on this. So if you could tell us, what is causing black fungus in some COVID survivors?
So we know that COVID itself is not something which causes fungal infection. But what happens is, because of COVID, two things happen. Your immunity comes down, you're more prone to what we call secondary bacterial and fungal infection, what is also known as an opportunistic infection. And some of the drugs that we give, and sometimes we give them in a dose which is not justified, also sort of predisposes to these fungal infection. So if you're getting very high dose steroids for a long time, or you're getting drugs like tocilizumab, which really knocks out your immune system, then your immunity is low. And if you have underlying, let's say, diabetes or certain other conditions which further decrease your immune system, you are very, very prone to getting a secondary infection, which could be a fungal infection. There are fungal infections and in the form of mucormycosis, which is what we are seeing now, what we sinuses in the nose and in the sinuses or in the lungs, which is causing sort of people to deteriorate in the later part of the illness and really land up again in hospital. So the message here is that avoid giving drugs which are not essential early in the disease, and be careful about the dosing. You don't have to high doses actually to save infection.
Right, doctor. So just to talk more about this, people with diabetes are the ones who are more prone to developing this black fungus. Also, what are the signs? How can the family or the patient watch out for whether they're developing this before it's too late? Because we're seeing very extreme cases as well.
So if you have what we call rhinocerebral mucormycosis, which is a fungal infection of sinuses, headache, sometimes you can have even loss of vision. I remember the last Saturday I had gone to our hospital in Jhajjar, and I'd gone in and I saw a patient there who actually had COVID, and he had lost vision in one of his eyes because of the fact that the fungal infection in the sinuses had gone up to his orbit, the eyeball, and caused a loss of vision in the eye. So that can happen. So you may have headache, you may have sort of blocked nose, and sometimes you can have your fever coming back and patches on the x-ray which look classically like a fungal infection. So you must really be on the lookout, and if fever comes back, if you have certain symptoms which are atypical, get yourself evaluated by your doctor to rule out a fungal infection, because then this needs to be treated aggressively, especially early rather than late.
All right. Well, coming back now to the medication, doctor, and you've spoken about steroids. So are steroids being used too early for COVID patients? This is something you have warned about, and I want you to elaborate on this so people really understand what you're talking about when you're saying, you know, that sometimes using steroids early is causing further complications.
So I'll really try and explain that from what we've known in the past. If we had a pandemic of what was known as swine flu or H1N1, and steroids were used then, and it was shown the steroids led to higher mortality, and they were therefore not indicated. COVID is a little different. COVID also causes a similar type of viral replication. It's a respiratory virus, but it also causes what we call a hyperinflammatory syndrome or a cytokine syndrome. Now, in the early stage, when the virus is replicating, steroids may actually promote the replication of the virus, and it may cause more harm. And this has been also shown in the recovery trial, where they used steroids in different sets of patients and found that in those patients who were steroids are given early, they had a higher mortality. They did worse as compared to those who did not get steroids. And that was linked to the fact that steroids may have actually promoted the virus to be able to replicate more, because steroids decrease your immune system, decrease your immunity. And therefore, you may actually land up with more viral infection or more severe viral pneumonia than you would have otherwise if you had not taken steroids. In the later part of the illness, the second phase, because COVID is a biphasic illness, the first part is when you have the viral replication. There you don't need to take steroids. The second part is when the viral replication is coming down, but now you're the body's immune system is becoming hyperactive. You have a hyperinflammatory reaction. Here you need to decrease the immune system, you need to decrease the inflammation, and here steroids play a very good role. And that's why what was really indicated was that after the fifth to seventh day, if your fever is persisting, your saturation is coming down, there are patches in the x-ray, then steroids usually play a very dramatic role. So it's in the later part of the illness that steroids may be more useful. In the early part of the illness, they may actually cause more harm.
And when you say steroids, if I can ask you, which ones are you talking about? We do know that this time around I've seen, because you know, I had COVID in the first wave, and in this particular wave, when friends have got COVID, they're being you know, asked to take budesonide, which is you know, an inhaler or a nebulizer. Then we do know that dexamethasone is something that is used by doctors later when one, you know, is in a more severe case. So if you could just tell us, what are you talking about when you say steroids?
So when you're talking of steroids, we're talking of oral or injectable steroids. Budesonide is an inhaler, so it's right. a much lower dose. It's a dose in micrograms. The dose in for others is in milligrams, and it's a locally acting drug. So that is useful. Budesonide is an inhaled drug, which to some extent may be useful in mild to moderate illness. But when we're talking of steroids, we're talking of drugs like dexamethasone, methylprednisolone, prednisolone. And their variants, because these are drugs which are taken orally or are given in an injectable form. And sometimes people take a very high dose. Even in the trials where it is, steroids have been used, even the recovery trial, it was a lower dose steroids which were found to be effective. So giving very high dose steroids may be counterproductive. And I've seen many patients who take high dose steroids, the sugars go haywire. Those who have borderline diabetes start having sugars of 400, 500. And there are some who were not diabetics. Suddenly the sugars become very high, and that also leads to secondary infection, like we were just talking of higher chance of fungal infections. Therefore, judicious use of steroids, and especially only in the later part of the illness, is something that we have to consider. They can be very useful, they decrease mortality, but they can also cause problems if they are not, if they're misused.
All right. Well, the next question is about antibiotics, because this is, again, something that, you know, many doctors are pointing out, doctors abroad also talking about, and that, you know, we do know as soon as you get COVID, many doctors are prescribing certain antibiotics. But now people are warning that there could be dangers of the widespread use of antibiotics.
Yes, there's always been the issue of what we call antimicrobial resistance. Unnecessary use of antibiotics actually predisposes to resistant bugs developing and antimicrobial resistance occurring, causing what we call multi-drug resistant pathogens, which then are very difficult to treat. And if you develop that in an ICU setting, it is associated with higher mortality and morbidity. Therefore, in my mind, we have to be very careful, and we should understand that COVID-19 is a viral infection. Antibiotics really have no role to play in that. It's only in the later part of the illness, if you're suspecting a secondary bacterial infection, like I said, if you're given steroids and if you're given drugs like tocilizumab, that you would like to give antibiotics. In the early part of the illness, really, there is no role of antibiotics. Some people use a drug called azithromycin, but that is used not for its antibiotic action, but sometimes as an immunomodulator. But otherwise, giving a large, many antibiotics or giving antibiotics in the early stages of the disease actually is no use. You're just trying to be you're over-medicating rather than giving drugs which are of any use.
And just speaking about drugs and steroids and antibiotics, something that you were mentioning earlier about how you must consult a doctor, because what's also happening, doctor, in this case, since you're having so many people in one family, you know, testing positive, is that people are just using each other's prescriptions. If one person is being prescribed certain, you know, care and certain medicines by their doctors, then the rest of the family just shares it and does the same thing. So could you tell us why this is not advisable?
So this is something that we've been doing for, I would say, long, long time, that even you people share their prescriptions with the neighbors, and you get the drugs over the counter. So it's very easy to get drugs, antibiotics, and that is has driven a lot of antibiotic resistance in our country. But I'd like to warn people here that you should not really share prescriptions. I know that many prescriptions get shared on WhatsApp, and they can actually be harmful because each individual needs a different set of prescriptions. You may have some drugs which may be common, but it depends on the stage of the illness, the type of illness you have, the comorbidities that you have, which decides the treatment strategy. One would be careful about giving some drugs depending on your comorbidities and the drugs that you're already taking, because there can be a drug-drug interaction. Secondly, it depends on how mild to severe your illness is, and that will decide on the treatment strategy. So copying each other's treatment prescription may sometimes cause more harm, and you may actually land up in a situation which may cause more complications.
Absolutely, and hope all viewers are listening and will, you know, desist from this very common activity currently. Now, doctor, you spoke about CT scans earlier this week, and it caused quite a sensation. So, and you said that not everybody needs a CT scan when you have COVID, that people were just going and getting too many CT scans. So, at what point does a COVID patient require a CT scan?
So, I'd like to just mention the CT scan. If you look at CT scans in general, over the last 30, 40 years, CT scans have revolutionized medicine in the fact that they have really helped us make diagnosis which we would not have been able to make, whether it be a CT head or a CT chest. And therefore, the treatment of many diseases and many, I would say, thousands or millions of lives have been saved by a CT scan. But CT scans have their harm also. They do lead to some degree of radiation exposure, and that has been documented. Secondly, they create a lot of panic because we know that you may have some patches in your lungs, even if you're asymptomatic. A study showed that almost 30% of individuals who had COVID were asymptomatic, had patches in their lung, and they became all right without any treatment. But now with the CT scan being done so often, sometimes this creates a panic and people get started on steroids, not based on their symptoms, but based on the CT scan. Therefore, those who are having mild illness, and that means almost 85% of people who have just fever, sore throat, cough, and saturation is well maintained, they don't need to get a CT scan. If on the fifth or sixth day, you are in the 15% who find that the saturation is falling, you're having breathlessness, you're having any of those red flag signs that I mentioned, then there may be an indication for getting a CT scan after consulting your doctor. But sometimes people get a CT scan on day one, and then they say that my CT on day one is all right, and I don't need to bother. I have no lung involvement. That itself is a misconception, because you may have features which may worsen over the next few days, and your CT on day six or seven may be worse than what it was on day one. So getting a CT scan early may actually give you a false sense of security. It may expose you to radiation, and it's not indicated. So CT scan is indicated only in those people who have moderate illness, moderate to severe illness, and usually after the fifth to sixth day.
I just like to elaborate on what you just said about how, you know, CT scans can detect if you have patches, but that's nothing to get, you know, overly worried about, because yes, that is one of the reactions that I saw to a lot of what the viewer feedback was regarding CT scans. They're saying, I was feeling perfectly normal even 2-3 days into my illness. Then I got a CT scan and I realized my lung had a slight patch on it. And, you know, I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't got the CT scan. So what would you say to that?
So that's exactly the point that I'm making, that you will pick up some patches on the lung, because this is a virus which actually goes down into the lung and causes some degree of inflammation. If you were to do nothing and you had not got your CT scan done, this patch would go away on its own, or with your own immune system taking care of it. That's what I said, that those individuals who had asymptomatic disease, they didn't even know they had COVID-19, they tested positive on RT-PCR, their CT scan showed patches in about 30% of patients, and without any treatment, they became all right. So CT scan sometimes causes more of a confusion rather than helps to resolve things, because you must go by the clinical picture rather than just by the radiological picture. People get panicky if they see a small patch on the CT,
right,
and then start steroids, start so many drugs, which actually may worsen the disease. So you must be careful about looking at CT scan holistically rather than treating just the scan. We need to treat the patient, not the scan. That is the most important thing to remember.
All right, a very important point there. Now, doctor, we're still dealing with the second wave, and there are already warnings of this third wave, and also the prediction that the third wave will hit children harder. And if you could just tell us what this means, why do experts feel this? I know a lot of children are now asking their parents, because everybody's watching the news these days, and a lot of children are asking their parents, oh, the third wave is going to affect me. So if you could just tell us about this.
So the concern is that if you start looking at the people who have got affected, and we've said younger people have got affected, and in the past, older people were also infected. The children are ones who are still vulnerable and susceptible, but have been protected till now. Schools have been closed. We've not allowed them to come out, and they are still a vulnerable population. So the worry is that when we have another wave, they are the ones who will be more susceptible and would get the illness much more than the others, who may have developed some immunity because of the exposure that they've had because of COVID-19 in the second wave. I think what we need to do is we need to look at strategies where we can see what the data is and try and quickly get vaccines which are approved for or get vaccines or trials done quickly, which are already being done, so that vaccines get approved for children also, and we start rolling it out for even children and people less than the age of 18 years, and are able to cover them or give them some degree of protection from the by giving them vaccines. So I think we have to start looking at vaccinating the younger age group also, and especially children, in the coming months.
Right, absolutely. And I hope we do move faster on that. We're running out of time now. One more question. Now that the vaccinations have opened up for, you know, people between ages of 18 to 44, a question we're getting a lot from young women is, can lactating mothers get vaccinated?
So that's an important question. And there are two parts of this question, which basically I'd like to address. One is lactating mothers and the other is pregnant women. As far as lactating mothers are concerned, the guidelines still being extra cautious mention that lactating mothers should avoid getting the vaccine. But there is now a lot of data which shows that they are safe. They can be vaccine can be taken by lactating mothers. As a matter of fact, a recent paper showed that by giving lactating mothers the vaccine, the antibodies which are produced are also produced in the breast milk. And the newborn who the mother is breastfeeding gets some immunity because these antibodies are then crossed over through the breast milk to this newborn. So it may be worthwhile to consider that lactating women should get themselves vaccinated. Regarding pregnancy, now pregnancy again, as per the guidelines are concerned, it is not currently recommended. But various associations, including the Federation of Obstetrics and Gynae, are now recommending that one should consider vaccinating pregnant women also, because there is data emerging that they have a higher morbidity, not only for the mother, but even for the fetus and for the newborn. And recent papers published both in JAMA and other international journals do suggest that getting COVID while you're pregnant may have a worse outcome. Therefore, I think we have to start considering vaccinating pregnant women also.
All right, well, we're completely out of time. Thank you so much, Dr. Guleria, for joining us on the show. And thank you, everyone, for watching.
Thank you.